Welcome, everybody. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy from Classic Album Sundays, and welcome to a very special event we're doing in collaboration with the Royal Albert Hall and their Love Classical program. We had a great event with Nitin Sawhney just a couple weeks ago, and coming up in July, our special guest is Matthew Herbert, but we have a very special guest for you tonight. But before I get into that, I just wanted to also introduce our sound system, because it's absolutely gorgeous. I want to thank Infidelity Hi-Fi for installing this. They're a great hi-fi shop over in Kingston upon Thames. We have Simon and Hitesh here. After tonight's event, if you'd like to learn more about the Hi-Fi, please make yourselves known to them. But just to kind of give you a little run through, we have a Riga P8 turntable. We have Name Electronics, a Riga Isis CD player. We have Name Cabling and these gorgeous Bowers & Wilkins D3-800 loudspeakers. So I know you're all here for the sound system. Yeah, for me as well, possibly, but definitely for our special guest. He started a record label in 1992, when he was only 18 years old, which is just absolutely astounding. And this record label is one of the most significant record labels in electronic music because it really pioneered alternative hip-hop and turntablism. It featured a lot of great artists like DJ Shadow, DJ Crush, and of course his own outfit, UNKLE. If you want to find out more about this special label, MoWax, you can watch a documentary. Some of you may already have seen it, The Man from MoWax, which came out last year. UNKLE has a new album out, and it's a beautiful album. It's called The Road Part 2, Lost Highways. And please welcome my very special guest. Please put your hands together for James Lavelle. I think you have a microphone. You may be sitting on it, possibly. There you go. Excellent. Well, the reason I asked you to do this event with me is because I remember you were interviewed for a radio show that I was hosting for Six Music called Sounds of a City, and it was a focus on Bristol. And you mentioned you grew up with classical music in your house.
Yeah.
Could you tell us a bit about that?
Well, my grandmother was a cellist and a pianist, and she was a piano and cello teacher, and my father was a jazz musician and basically a sort of musicologist, really. Came from growing up with her. My grandfather was a singer, an opera singer, so classical music and jazz was kind of the foundation of what I grew up as a very young child.
Mm-hmm. Now, your grandmother is quite decorated, wasn't she? She won an award?
Yeah, you know what? It's terrible. My grandmother won. She came from Southern Ireland, and you know, to be a woman at that time, to be involved in the arts was difficult. And she basically became one of the most celebrated cellists of her time, and was a professional, brilliant professional cellist. But unfortunately, my grandfather died, and she had to bring up two children in England, coming from Southern Ireland. And in the 50s, if people remember what most of the door signs were like in the 1950s, the Irish weren't. It wasn't the easiest thing. So she,
as well,
yeah,
actually.
Yeah. So she, fortunately, she became a teacher, and but sort of instilled in my father and his brother that they couldn't be professional musicians and had to get proper jobs. And that's why I ended up growing up in Oxford, because my father ended up going to Oxford University and living there. And then I became, I don't know what I became, but I was involved in music.
Still trying to figure out what you became.
Yes, still desperately
trying
to figure
it out. We all are. It's a constant evolution, isn't it? Now, your father ended up doing some things in classical music later on in his life, didn't he, with Rosalind Turek?
Yes, so he became her kind of, I don't know what the right word would be, like sponsor, really.
And patron?
Patron, yes. So he was her patron at the end of her life. And Yeah.
She was quite a remarkable woman.
Yeah, I believe so. I don't know that much about her.
Well, she was, you know, she was a specialist. She was an American pianist who specialized in Bach, also played Brahms, Chopin, Beethoven. But she's the only pianist that Glenn Gould, who, the late Glenn Gould, said was an inspiration. And that's saying something, because he is known as the pianist for Bach. So she was really something.
Yeah, my father would, you know, said to me that she was, in his mind, the greatest player of Bach that was the last great player of Bach of her generation. Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, it's amazing that you kind of grew up with this music in the house, and I'm sure it influenced you in probably ways you weren't even aware of at the time. But one thing that really got yourself into how you got into classical music yourself was through soundtracks.
Yeah, I mean, I started learning cello when I was 8, and I got to grade 8. But I then discovered the wonders of Kung Fu, to this dismay of my grandmother and my father, and through Kung Fu and being at school and the wonders of this new emerging music called hip hop, which was quite synonymous with martial arts, as black music was, that's where my path, you know, in the world I am now started. But before that, there was music was a major part of the household. So my father was really into buying records and hi-fi and, you know, classics, 80s hi-fi in the house, and you'd congregate around the hi-fi and you'd listen to John Coltrane, Miles Davis, Stevie Wonder, and a lot of classical music. And I think, you know, inadvertently, that kind of has stuck with me through, you know, but the way I really got into classical music was through film soundtrack, actually, initially, yeah.
I have to back up a bit. So how did your parents feel when you said you were giving up the cello for hip-hop for a couple of turntables?
Not very well. My mother was more... my mum was pretty open-minded. My mum was quite an avant-garde artist, and therefore, you know, to her it was okay. But I think it was more the classic thing of giving up an instrument. And like every parent tells their children, don't give up, you'll regret it. And guess what? You do.
Exactly.
You regret
I have the same
it.
Thing too. Same thing with piano and organ. And my daughter's going through a similar thing right now, but she wants to switch instruments. So I thought, okay, yeah. If you have to do that, that's fine. I will not be like my parents, so we all are, aren't we? Okay, so backing up now, moving ahead, I should say. So you got into film soundtracks, and there's one from a special Stanley Kubrick film that really enamored you.
Well, I think sort of looking back on moments that were really important growing up as a kid. So I, you know, when you're sort of 12 years old and you're really starting to get into records and I suppose counterculture, you have to understand that, you know, for our generation, you know, we didn't have the internet, you didn't have accessibility to a lot of things. So the record store and the video store were your prime places of cultural entertainment for me growing up. And I was sort of, you know, very, very hardcore in sort of finding things. And obviously I couldn't go to clubs and I couldn't go to a lot of the places where you would experience these things. So I had to discover things through these outlets. And the video store was very into science fiction and most of the sort of, and, you know, the sort of, a lot of the B, what we consider to be B movies of the era that have all gone on to become incredibly powerfully important and celebrated. So, you know, you'd go, you know, I was Star Wars generation, so you'd go to the video store and you'd start looking at all these films and what is that? Oh, there's this film called Blade Runner. I've never heard what that is. What's that weird film? Or Tron? Or, oh, there's a film called 2001, you know. So when I was about 12, I got 2001 and took it home. I didn't know what it was. And that was my introduction to Stanley Kubrick. And it has obviously one of the most powerful openings using classical music for me. And I think, you know, the relationship between music and the visual world has always been something that's hugely influenced me, and I think many other people. So this sort of combination of discovering music through film and television, you know, because on the flip side to that, I was really into things like James Bond and the soundtracks from James Bond and, you know, sort of, and John Barry and, you know, et cetera. So, that was there was this sort of side which I loved, and then there was the side of this emerging new music, which was electro and hip hop, which I was discovering, you know.
Well, the theme is from Richard Strauss, also sprach Zarathustra, also spoke Zarathustra, or also spake, if you want to do old English. Why was this so indelible? Or what was it about? What was so evocative about this theme song for you?
I mean, it's just power. It was so powerful. And it's sort of, and the sort of, it's hard to explain. I mean, I think for many of us, it's one of the greatest openings, both musically and visually, of something. And it's the feeling of imagination and sort of taking you into another world. That's something that moment in that film and with that piece of music. And I think how powerful music and film can be when it's done together. And I don't know, it's just one of those things that just hit my soul. It just made me feel something in a way that I'd never felt like that when I'd watched a movie really before, so much, you know. And I think just talking, you know, coming to, you know, us, when we're talking about what the influences were, I think I'm just trying to look right back at why, you know, obviously this family influence with classical music, but then all of these other things, why then that's sort of how that's gone into my work later on. And so I think that is one of them, a pivotal moment for me of classical can feel contemporary. And I think that's what was so clever about Stanley Kubrick and how he used music in the film, that, you know, something which is very traditional as a piece of music in a certain way suddenly becomes the most contemporary thing you've ever felt, because of what you're seeing and how that's being used. And actually, you know, 2001 originally had a different score, and that score was more of a sort of 50s, sort of early 60s electronic sort of, you know, and he got rid of that, and he decided to use reappropriate very classic, you know, pieces of music but using them in what would be considered a very contemporary way. And then later on went and sort of, you know, reconstructed and deconstructed things by working with people like Wendy Carlos. So, you know, when you look at something like the opening of The Shining, that's kind of one of the first remix, electronic, classical remix records, you know, with Beethoven and stuff like that. Actually, Beethoven was in Clockwork Orange. But, you know, how things have been played around. And I think, you know, it's just very powerful.
I think it's probably given the film longevity as well, as well as being an amazing film with great acting.
Yeah, I mean, maybe if the score is available to listen to. My memory is terrible, but the composer. Mm-hmm. But it's very different to what, you know, the power of, yeah, how that film is sort of, the yin and yang of that film, I think, score, and is so central to how in longevity. I think if it was something which was more, at the time, may have seemed more futuristic, it would have probably not lasted the test of time.
Exactly. Know. Well, let's have a listen. Quite grandiose.
It's very powerful.
Incredibly powerful. Well, the next selection is powerful, but in a much, much different way.
Yeah.
And it is from I don't know if this is the first time you heard it. I'm sure you had heard the song many times before in your own home, but it's Adagio for strings.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell us why you chose this one?
Because it's, you know, in my top 10 favorite pieces of music of all time. Mm. It's one of my biggest sort of influences as a piece of music, and it's one of the most beautiful pieces of music I think ever made, especially as a classical piece. It's you know, it's a sort of record that I think bridged my relationship with my father about where I, you know, our relationship with classical music and where and how I would articulate what I was wanting to do with making records. Like, so for instance, when I worked on Science Fiction, my first album, and I met the arranger and the brilliant arranger and composer Will Malone, who made records like Massive Attack and Unfinished Sympathy, etc. I said to him that I wanted to make a record like Adagio for String. I wanted the string arrangement to be like, you know, Adagio for String, and he laughed and said, "Okay, we're okay, let's do this." And you know, it's just something that has a hugely powerful effect on me as a piece of music, and you know.
Well, it was composed by Samuel Barber, the American composer, in 1936. And it's used for a lot of kind of a public mourning, actually. It's played and publicly when people have passed, like John F. Kennedy, Albert Einstein, Princess Diana. So it's a very powerful piece of music and very melancholic. I remember the first time I heard it, I think it was through Ryuichi Sakamoto, again, through a whole other different way. And it just struck me. I just was like, wow, I've never heard this before. It was just so evocative.
Yeah.
Can you remember the first time? Maybe the first time you heard it wasn't on this soundtrack, but it's something you have to
attach
to the soundtrack.
I heard it with my father, but I think I always remember it as being so powerful when I first saw Platoon for the first time as a young kid. And I think it's just something I can't describe when certain records make you feel a certain way. It's just something that I can listen to again and again and again. And it's, I think that it's probably the basis of my relationship in a purely classical way of what I've taken into my own records.
And how do you think it adds to the gravitas of the actual film?
I think it's that's the moment, you know. It's the moment, you know, he's on his knees, you know. It's a powerful moment, you know. And it, again, the relationship for me with how cinema and music works when it's that perfect unity is something incredibly amazing, you know, incredibly powerful.
Well, we're going to listen to the rendition from the Platoon soundtrack from Oliver Stone's 1986 movie. And let's have a listen. It's just such a beautiful piece of music. It really is absolutely stunning. And I think it's fair to say that you're somewhat obsessed with strings.
Indeed, yeah.
Funny how I noticed that. Well, the next song we're going to play is something that's a bit more modern, certainly more modern than 1936. And it's a song that I've heard you call your favorite song.
Yeah.
And possibly, I would think, knowing what you started to produce after this album yourself with Mo Wax, possibly an inspiration for your musical career as well.
Yeah.
I think it's safe to say.
I think
do you want to tell us about it?
Massive Attack's Unfinished Sympathy, yeah. I mean, the album as a whole was pretty much a benchmark for me and all of my friends growing up, you know. So I think what's fascinating with a record like this is, you know, the combination of everything from the artwork to the lyrics to the production. But I always find it quite, with a record like Unfinished Sympathy specifically, and actually a lot of what's on the album, is how amazing it is that a group of, you know, mid-20-year-old artists who came from essentially, you know, not being... negative, but you know, not academically educated young artists, and this is prevalent in so many great records, could come up and make such an incredibly intellectually and brilliantly, you know, piece of record like this, you know. And everything, the artwork, the photography, and also, you know, for me growing up, it was the sound system culture was everything me and my friends were part of and aspiring to be, and they were the leaders of that, because pre-Massive Attack there was the Wild Bunch, and the Wild Bunch kind of helped start everything pretty much here in contemporary dance music. So, you know, Nellie Hooper was part of it, who went on to do Soul to Soul and Bjork and everything else, and the, you know, some of the remainders ended up, you know, three of them ended up doing Massive Attack, and then you had Milo, and, you know, there was a relationship with Major Force in Japan and all these things, which are quite the building blocks of where I grew up on, but pretty much the building blocks of contemporary British, you know, dance music, as it were. You know, even though they'd hate me calling it dance music, but, you know.
Well, it's a very, very wide term, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, they were playing all different types of things as the Wild Bunch as well.
Yeah.
Did you ever go to any of their gigs?
I was too young.
That's what I figured. Yeah, too young. So.
Just a little bit too young.
Yeah. Well, this song that we're going to play has a string arrangement by Will Malone.
Yeah.
Would you like to talk about the strings in particular? And
yeah, I mean, I think just to hear a record like this when you're growing up, and especially at the time, a lot of the records we're hearing were very bombastic and were not so crafted in a sort of musicianship way. They were sample based and electronic, you know, drum machine based, and you know, and cut up, and you know, whether it was house music or hip hop, you know. And suddenly you hear this record come along, which has all of those elements, but has just the most mind-blowing string arrangement, and the power of that as a, you know, as a sort of 15, 16-year-old, where, you know, to experience that in that world was quite mind-blowing, you know.
And did you start to think that maybe your upbringing with classical music was starting to become a little bit more cool?
Indeed, yes. And I think it spoke to me on all of those levels, because it's, you know, coming from loving classical music and growing up in that environment, but also feeling slightly, you know, it wasn't cool. To then hear a record like that, which had fused every element, you know, and I mean, I have the stems for the record, and even when you start going into the production, it's quite an extraordinarily made record, and it's a very interesting song as well, because it wasn't called Unfinished Sympathy; it was called Kiss and Tell, and so the whole thing was that the chorus, nobody liked the chorus, and so Will Malone decided to take they sort of didn't want the chorus in there, so they took the chorus out and gave it to Will. And Will created this arrangement based on the idea there was no chorus, and hence why the strings are so prevalent and sort of define this track so much, you know.
It is probably one of the greatest dance tunes of all time, I have to say, man.
I think so. I think
DJ.
It's actually one of the greatest British records, one of the greatest singles of its time, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's have a listen.
Cool.
It is just a stunning piece of music.
What a combination. I mean, also, you just, you know, the vocal, Sheryl Nelson, I mean, the lyrics, it's a brilliant record. You know,
it is.
It's beyond brilliant.
And it really is. I remember when it came out, I had the CD, and I had a CD Walkman, and I used to walk around New York City playing it, thinking I was Sheryl Nelson, you know, it was really great. So I bet when you heard that, you thought, why did I give up the cello? And your dad was
feeling pretty
smug.
I thought, you know what, you see, it can work. Mum, Dad, look, it's great. I mean, I remember I got a cassette of that record just before it came out, and I think, you know, as you did in those days, you know, I think I was 15 when I got the cassette. So I just remember going back to my bedroom at my mum's, and I locked myself in that room. And probably I must have listened to it for a week nonstop in my headphones, you know. And, you know, I think it's just, there are those moments where you can see in music the perfect combination of where everything collides so well. The lyrics, the performance, the arrangement, the vibe in the room, that record smells of, you know, you can feel it. You can feel everything in that record was sort of, they you know, annoyingly they got right for me, you know, because you just spend your life just going, I want to be able to do that, you know. It's you know, there's certain records in your life, you know, when you know we're playing, you know, through some of them earlier, or you know, you hear Marvin Gaye, What's Going On, you're like, how yeah. You know,
it only took a month
to
record.
Comes when those all of those elements, I think that's what's amazing in music, when all of those elements, or any great art, or is when you just get that combination, and it what comes out of that combination, that great cocktail. And you know, and it's, for me, you know, as a 15, 16-year-old to hear that, I can't explain what it was like to hear a record like that.
Well, it seems like it was life-changing for you,
yeah,
because
yeah.
You must have thought, I want to do that.
I wanted to do that, and just, it felt like you could. Mm. You know, like, I think what you have to understand about that era and hip-hop and what that coming out of hip-hop, because to me that was like, when you hear a record like The Clash compared to early some of The Clash compared to earlier punk records, like, you know, you're defined, you're getting involved in things, you're finding out, and you've never heard anything like it. I didn't have older brothers or sisters, so I wasn't exposed to, you know, like a lot of my friends would say, oh, I remember my brother played me, you know, the Sex Pistols or whatever it was, you know, and that moment to me, you know, even though I'd collected and been listening to a lot of hip-hop and was DJing when that record came out, never had heard anything quite like it that touched, you know, emotionally touched you in that way, you know. And I think, you know, that's obviously a lot to do with Sheryl Nelson, because the words in that song are quite extraordinary, you know. And there are certain records as a DJ that you just never leave your box, and that's one record that I'm owed a lot of PRS for helping them out, I think, the amount of times I played that record.
And it also has to be a last tune of the night, because you can't follow it up with anything else.
It's one of those moments. For me.
So this is the record that really inspired you, I think it's safe to say, to start Mo Wax in 1992.
I think if you just want to encapsulate, you know, it's hard. There's millions of, there's lots of records, lots of labels, but if you're trying to encapsulate something into a moment like this evening, that record, because it's not just about the music. You've got to think about the videos, the painting, the fact that it was multicultural. So when you were in a crew, you know, I was in a multicultural group of kids growing up DJing. Everybody could identify, everybody wanted to be somebody. In the same way you have that with bands, you know, not everybody wants to be the lead singer. You know, that's the sort of one of the things that's sad about not bands necessarily evolving at the moment. We're in a world where everybody's all about the star. Yeah. But what it makes you realize is you can all be part of something. And that, so it's a combination of all of those elements. You know, I wanted to be 3D. My friend wanted to be mushroom or whatever. Do you know what I mean? And it sort of allows your imagination to wander and allows you to feel that these things are possible. Mm-hmm. You know.
Well, it's great because you started so young as well. I mean, you're 18 years old when you co-founded MoWax.
No, I'd like to.
You just, did you find? I wasn't sure.
No.
It was with some Goldsworthy,
no,
so it wasn't.
No.
Let's
no.
set the record straight.
No, seriously,
so to speak.
I'm sorry, but it's really it wasn't. No. We started UNKLE together. Yes.
Right. So with UNKLE, your debut album came out in 1998,
yes.
Science Fiction, which you did with DJ Shadow at the time.
Yeah.
And it's because UNKLE is really your kind of...
Well, I started it with Tim originally as a sort of hypothetical. We just had an idea of doing remixes and productions, so I started doing remixes with him. And also involved with that was Kudo from Major Force, which was a Japanese label. And we did a series of remixes and we did some, you know, released some records and we started making the first UNKLE record in LA at... G-Sum, which was the Beastie Boys studio with Mario Cardato, who produced Check Your Head and Ill Communication. But, you know, as they say, never go and make your first record. Try and make your first record in LA when you're 21 years old and get a load of cash.
Really? Why is that?
Because
tell us.
For some reason, it just doesn't seem to... Records don't get made and other things get done.
I think Fleetwood Mac knows something about that.
Yeah,
and they're even a bit older.
Yeah. And we started making this record that never happened. And when I came back, me and Tim split. Tim then went off to start DFA, which he did start with James Murphy. And I... pursued doing the UNKLE with at that time with DJ Shadow and made Science Fiction.
Now, one of the first songs that you recorded is a song that you wanted to play tonight featuring Richard Ashcroft, and there's a reason why you picked this.
Yeah, so I mean, I suppose going the joining the dots of the conversation, so, you know, the track Lonely Soul was, Science Fiction was quite a complicated record to make because you didn't have the internet, you couldn't sort of make a track. You know, nowadays I can be in London, somebody else can be in America, you can send parts across the line and you don't have to be in the same studio, or, you know, in those days that wasn't the way things were done. And so to try and be in the same room with people was quite difficult. But funnily enough, the first track we ever recorded and the first vocal that was ever recorded for Science Fiction was Lonely Soul. And, you know, but by the time the record, that was pre the Verve getting back together. And by the time the record came out, you know, the song probably took about a year and a half, 2 years to get finished because of the way that, you know, then you had to get, you know, you did a demo vocal, then you'd have to get Richard back in the studio, then he would go off and then you'd have to get back in. So it was a very long process. But it was the first vocal recorded for the album as a song. And then it was how my relationship with Will Malone started, because I then went to see Will and asked him to do string arrangement for the song and asked him to do something like Adagio for strings. And the idea was to have this sort of what was a vocal piece. So the record, originally the demo was a beat with a sort of a string loop and Richard. And then what I wanted to try and do and sort of persuaded Will and Shadow was to then take it off into this journey. And so you had the song, but it would be more like a suite and would take you off into a different section. So the song has its main verse chorus part, but then it takes you into this sort of more instrumental part, which becomes more dominant by the strings. And that was quite an experience. And it was also a record that I then sent to Stanley Kubrick, because I tried to ask Stanley Kubrick to direct as you do when you're 22 years old and think you can do anything.
Hey, Michael Jackson did it with Spielberg,
yeah,
right?
I tracked down at a time when Stanley Kubrick was supposedly not, nobody knew whether he was live or not. I managed to track a number down for his assistant and I sent him, I asked his assistant about would he be interested in directing a video for this song, and they send it, and I was then told, really interesting, why don't you, you know, Stanley's kind of, you know, why don't you give him a call in 6 months when he's finished his film, you know, he's wrapping up his new film, and he passed, unfortunately.
So but, you didn't
but
hold
I then
up
went
for...
on recently, not too long ago, to work with his family on a show at Somerset House.
And I saw that you have a song called Kubrick on your
album.
We'll get into that later, though.
I
think this is absolutely beautiful. What was it like? You work with the London Session Orchestra. Were you there for the actual session?
I was. I've been in every string session that I've ever recorded, yeah.
What was
which
that
I'm
like?
Which I'm fascinated to find, which I find very interesting, is that so many artists and bands that I love have not attended their sessions.
That is kind of crazy.
Mass Attack weren't in the session for
Well, yeah, they were. They're so laid back, though, aren't they?
But I mean, I find it amazing that of all the sessions you want to be in, there's, you know, it's the it's as a musician, just to be able to sit there and watch potentially a 30-piece orchestra play on your song, to me, is that's what it's all about. So yeah, I was that was at CTI Studios in West London, which I don't think exists anymore.
Did you, was the hair like standing up on your skin?
I mean, it's every time I do it, even to this day, you know, I recorded in Air Studios last year with Will, and it is, for me, one of the most beautiful things you can experience is being in a studio. And when, you know, the luxury, you know, I don't spend as much in big studios anymore because you don't have to.
Yeah.
And but to record, you know, an orchestra, you know, you go to an amazing studio, and it's an extraordinary experience. You know, to sit there and to have the most. You know, when, because what you have to remember about a lot of these orchestras as well is they are the players in those orchestras. They're the best. They're better than the Philharmonic or anybody like that, because they've made it to the point where they're able to record on all these records, and so you are with the greatest, you know, orchestral players in a room watching them play music that you've made. It is, there is, if you love music as we all do, it is, you know, you make music in sometimes much as an emotional thing, but as a fan, and to sit there, you suddenly become, it is just, I can't explain how amazing. It's the most intimate, personal experience to have 35 people playing to maybe you and two other people in the studio. You know,
it's quite,
it is.
The acoustics of the studio as
and because it's so well, the sound and the acoustics are so well done. Mm-hmm. It's something I'm blessed to be able to have experienced a few times in my life. Aww. You know.
Well, let's have a listen to Lonely Soul. I can't imagine what was going through your head. I would have cried, I think, right then and there in the studio, you know, hearing and watching the orchestra playing that.
Yeah, it was pretty powerful. I don't know what was going on in my head at the time either, trying to make some crazy shit. What I remember is sort of giving it to the record company, and sort of everybody's like, okay, what are we going to do with this?
Well,
where's the single?
Yeah, where's the single, exactly. But I've read, you stated to The Guardian a few years ago that intersection of classical music, electronic music, and hip-hop has been the basis of all of your music, and you can certainly hear it.
I think I sort of consider myself a sampler and a collagist, you know, so it's like trying to take, like a magpie, all of these bits and this, make this puzzle work somehow. But I think it's the basis of things, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so madly looking for the...
Oh, it's here. Okay, it's on my side.
I was just going to have to do something on stage I really don't want to do and put this back in without its sleeve. That'd be really bad for me to do on camera, certainly. So let's fast forward a few albums. And you hadn't put out an album for about 7 years, I believe, until you put out The Road Part 1, which was inspired by your curation of the Meltdown Festival, if you could tell us about
that. I wouldn't say it was inspired by... I had, you know, the incarnation of UNKLE had moved on, and that was difficult. And so for a while I hadn't really been in the right place to that I felt to make a record. You know, I just hadn't, I didn't feel that I wanted to. And I started, the first record I sort of made after a few years was Queens of the Stone Age Like Clockwork, which was the title track off there, not the last album, the album before. And that kind of was quite a good confidence thing of getting back in the studio and doing this track, which I was very proud of, and another track with strings. And then I was asked to curate Meltdown, which was one of the most humbling and amazingly rewarding experiences in my career thus far.
Why is that?
Because I think especially here, it's such an accolade in sort of the idea of what you've musically put into culture here. And I think also it was very important because I was sort of the first person, I think, especially for me, if you look at the list of amazing people that have curated Meltdown, it wasn't a traditional musician, you know, a singer or a great player. It was coming more from a cultural angle of what music and culture that one had been involved with. So it was incredibly, and also it's the South Bank, it's the Royal Festival Hall, it's, you know, I've lived here most of my life, you know, it's, there's nothing, you know, to be able to curate a venue like that for 10 days and experience that, but also the whole process of building up to that is such an incredible thing. And, you know, to do it, and then, you know, the opening show was an UNKLE show, and, you know, hadn't played for a long time, and you sort of get paranoid, are people going to be interested, does anybody want to play with you, what are you going to do? And so I made it easier myself, and I got 82 people to perform that night. And I had, you know, from, you know, it was incredibly beautiful to have from DJ Shadow being involved, and through to, you know, the London Contemporary Orchestra. I worked with a great woman called Mara Carlisle, who helped put it all together with me. And, you know, there were brilliant performances like from Mark Lanegan to Rosie Lowe to Keaton Henson. There was a lot of stuff going on. And then throughout that 10 days, all of these wonderful artists that, you know, from the past, from the present, people that I was discovering. And it just, I think after that, it just really gave me, you know, I wanted to go back and make another record. So, and also, you know, collaborate with a lot of the people that had performed, people that I hadn't necessarily worked with or seen performing before, people like Esker, and, you know, working with people like Keaton, and also on a production level, people that I met who I collaborated, you know, writing wise and production wise. So it was a great catalyst for me to sort of, you know, confidence wise, you know, to feel that I could, you know, that I wanted to make another record, you know.
And there's a theme to this record too, because is this going to be a trilogy, by the way? It will be a trilogy. Yeah, so this is part one. Can you talk us through what part one is thematically?
So I suppose in that respect, part one is like that thing of leaving home, going out, you know, starting, you know, and this sort of, there's a certain naivety about that experience in life, you know. So I'm sort of going right back to the beginning, and I was looking at certain influences from when I first started, you know. And, you know, I'm known for, a lot of people know you sort of a lot from, whether it's Mowax or predominantly UNKLE now, but my career started, I sort of had a career before that as a DJ playing with people like Giles Peterson and in sound systems and stuff. So I went, there was elements of that I wanted to experiment with and sort of, you know, sort of going back to the beginning, but also this sort of feeling of, in my, you know, as a metaphor for myself, is just how I was feeling of sort of wanting to, you know, I was bruised, I was tired from what had happened over the years with UNKLE, and I wanted to start again. And I found myself as a, you're never a solo artist when you, you know, in many ways when you make records, especially, you know, the idea of when you're in the studio and how you put records together, and especially these kind of records where they're very production-led records. So whilst I sort of had this thing where I'm, as the signed artist, as the face of UNKLE, I'm on my own. Yeah. But of course, you bring all these people in to help you, you know, realise these ideas. And so for me, it was a kind of the idea of this first record was kind of starting again, and part one. And part two, which came out recently, is more of the sort of the journey you find yourself in that middle period of your life where you're discovering and experimenting and things. And the last record's about coming home. Mm. So it has a kind of Joseph Campbell. I'm very into the mythology. So there's a sort of Joseph Campbell's hero's journey. There's, you know, the Odyssey and, you know, and Odysseus and all of those sort of things that in a trying not to, not in an overly conceptual way, but just what's in my head when I'm trying to put things together, that was, those were sort of part of the ideas of how I was laying, I'm laying out this journey. And also the road is also this thing of, I find myself recording in unusual situations. So whilst I didn't make a record, I ended up collaborating with a lot of people in unusual places and going and doing music for exhibitions and theatre shows. And, you know, you'd be in, you know, working with educational programs and things. So, you know, one minute I was in, you know, I found myself in somewhere like Cuba doing, working with local musicians. Then I'd be in Venice at Biennale and I'd be collaborating with artists there. And you make all this work and then suddenly it sort of disappears. And I'm like, I want this. So I wanted it to be a bit of a diary of work. So from when it started 4 years ago until the next record comes out, it also acts as a diary for me. It acts as a way of being able to put this music out and it having this sort of, so, you know, you have the sort of metaphorical journey of the road, but you also have, it's this creative journey, you know, and these records represent pieces of music that have been made through that process and that period, you know.
Now, musically, how is this album, part one, how is it inspired by classical music?
Well, everything I, you know, there's always an epicness, the critics would say. And I'm very, you know, I like making sort of quite, I suppose, soundtrack, you know, esque music. So strings and classical arrangement have a huge part in my records. And you know, and also, you know, what's funny is every time, you know, this came a point. So when I started doing The Road Part One, the last record I did before that, what tended to happen is I'd start collaborating with somebody as a partnership in the band, or whether it's a band in the project. And everybody would be like, you know what we want to do? We don't want to do anything like you did before. So let's get rid of the strings. Let's get rid of all that. And, you know, when it came to doing this, to doing The Road, I was like, I kind of wanted to just go back and go, what is it that I like about UNKLE? What do I think that the things that I enjoy about the records I make and the process of making those records and the people I want to work with. And so I wanted to bring all of that into, you know, at the time of doing the first part, as much of that as possible into what I thought UNKLE represented, you know, what I wanted to say, what I thought it meant musically, sonically and stuff like that.
And what is that? What is the answer to that question?
I'm still trying to work it out.
Maybe by part three. Yeah, exactly.
But in the sense that I whilst I was working with people that I hadn't worked with before and a lot of contemporary musicians and you know, writers, I also went back and I called people like Will Malone and Philip Shepherd, who are two, you know, the sort of backbone of my, you know, classical elements of my records, and it was like, right, let's go back and start again. What, you know, let's do this. Let's get back in a room and, you know, make some music. You know.
So who did the arrangement for the one we're going to listen to, Looking for the Rain?
Will Malone again.
This is Will Malone again. Yeah, so what's it like working with him?
Will is how do you describe Will? So Will is a really interesting guy. He started making records in the late 50s. He then went on to do things like, he did the score for Tommy. He produced the first Iron Maiden record. He has the rarest, his solo record is the rarest ever British psych record. The most expensive rare British psych record.
That.
He spent 6 months doing acid in Marrakesh in the 70s. You know, what is it? Will is just like one of those incredible sort of characters. He's a character. He's like, to me, he's sort of like Gandalf or something, you know. And he's wise and wonderful, but he's kind of hermity in his world. And you have to go to Will's world, and that's kind of going back to basics. And, you know, you're sort of, and it's all about, you know, he loves science fiction. He loves, you know, sort of, we always talk about what is it in the music? You know, there's always got to be a hint of sort of mischief. But he's also incredibly into beautifully arranged classical records and also
you know, knows, you know, he's very, his breadth of musicology is really great. So you can, you'll be talking about anything from Samuel Barber to Barry White and the arrangements.
Iron Maiden,
you know.
Or Black Sabbath.
Yeah. And so he's just, you know, I love people that are so open-minded and live and breathe what they do. And he's just got this, he's the real deal. He is this just, this, there's something about Will that is completely unique. And he's also, you know, I started working with him when I was 20, 21. And his, you know, I moved from Oxford. I was kind of here on my own a lot. And him and his family became a kind of surrogate family for me. So I've always spent a lot of time just going and hearing stories and talking about music and sort of, he's sort of been a sort of kind of godfather figure to me, you know.
I think you should make a film with them called Will's World.
Will's World,
that'd
yeah.
be nice.
It's an amazing world. You know.
Okay, I think I have this one queued up properly.
Right.
Third song?
I think so.
We were okay. looking at this.
Yes, spec. It is. It's okay. the third track.
Fingers
yeah.
crossed.
Yeah.
I'm really
yeah, yeah.
hoping.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I think this album, Part 1, The Road Part 1, and your latest album, Part 2, which just came out a few months ago, I guess. A few weeks ago, actually.
About a month ago. About
a month ago. Yeah. I think it's the most beautiful work that you've done. I mean, what do you think? It's hard to judge your own work, but listening back, now you're sitting here almost sitting as a listener.
Even though when I hear Lonely Soul, I'm just, I don't know, it's, yeah, I think, thank you.
Yeah. Well, it's very cinematic, as you were saying before.
Yeah.
And now we'll speed on up to the latest album, which is Part 2 of this trilogy. And you've called this one a mixtape. Why is that?
Well, I think what's interesting is how, you know, when you how you articulate things to sometimes it's very important so people can understand what they're getting themselves into, especially when you are in the abundance of information that we are dealt with at the moment. I had a lot of eclectic songs. I wanted to put them out, and I, you know, the first record, Part 1, is quite cohesive sonically, and it's the shortest record I've ever made, which was quite intentional in a way. It's 48 minutes, wherever, you know, what you've got to understand is, you know, back in the day, you could only have, you know, tracks on, were limited to the space you could use. So vinyl, you can only get a certain amount of music on a piece of vinyl. So maybe you get two pieces of vinyl if you're lucky. CD comes along and CD is 74 minutes. So every UNKLE album is 74 minutes because, from in the early days, because it was like we just want to get as much as possible into this record. And so when it came to the first Road Part 1, I wanted to make something which was a bit more, you know, it had been a long time. I realised that, you know, we consume records in a different way. And so I made a shorter record. Then the Road Part 2, I had a lot of material from, you know, material that had been recorded over that process and new stuff. But it was very eclectic. And I'd been doing a radio show, which I'd really enjoyed, the fact that you spend your life DJing in clubs and you tend to be playing for certain reasons to encourage people to dance. Whereas being on the radio, you just have this space where you can weave and take people on a journey. And that's what I love about radio, good radio. And so when I had a double album's worth of material, and I was like, how do I get from the first time, you know, a cover version, acoustic, classical cover version of, the, you know, the first time I ever saw your face, through to a record like Armor, which is a kind of hip-hop meets Blade Runner track, through to, you know, I don't know, a rock track like Crucifixion, where you're in a studio with Chris Goss, Twiggy, and, you know, Troy, and half of Queens of the Stone Age. And how do you make this all kind of work? And so I tried to look at it more as the idea of, you know, a road trip, a journey, like when you're in a car, you know, as I would have listening cassettes back in the day and making, you know, these mix cassettes and then DJ mixes and how the radio works. And I thought, you know, if I could present it more like it was a mixtape or a radio show, in the sense of how the beginning, middle and end works, it sort of made more sense putting it together, and hopefully how people can digest that, you know.
Well, you picked out a certain song, Only You. Do you want to tell us why you picked this one out?
Because it's a very, you know, it's interesting. So the way that the journey of music, and hence the road. So I was working on a TV show for Danny Boyle called Trust last year, which I recorded a lot of music, new music for. But I also had some existing UNKLE demos and tracks that I played Danny that he wanted to use in the series. So there was this one track that he wanted to use, which was it was an instrumental. And we then, you know, it was we recorded all these strings with Will, and you know, it was used in the show, but it was, you know, it was an original piece of music that I'd already made, and so I wanted it to be on the new album. So the idea was to reappropriate it, and I like the way you do that in music, and you can hear versions, especially when you're into sort of reggae and stuff like that. You can hear, you know, you can hear how records have changed and things, you know, change over time. So this track was sort of a track that it kind of has had this journey. And I started working with this really great young musician in London called Mink. And he's a brilliant, you know, producer, engineer, music, you know, one of these wonder kids who does everything, you know, and also has a really great voice and sort of more contemporary way of delivering his vocals and sonically. So it became a kind of collaboration of taking this existing piece that I had, you know, it's this incredible Will Malone arrangement, the fact, you know, and trying to sort of reconstruct it in a way that would work, you know, would change it on the album. And so then Mink added his stuff to it, and this is an example of how that can happen.
How did Danny feel about you reappropriating this?
Oh yeah, great. Danny is one of the, you know, it's funny because I you know, the relationship working with him, what I found fascinating is that I talk about everything in music like film, yeah. And he's described everything he talks about, how his process is, he describes it like music.
Oh, that's fantastic.
So it's a really amazing way to meet, because unfortunately, a lot of the time when you're working on film and television, depending on the people you're working with, but a lot of the time people just don't have a fucking clue. And it's really hard to articulate things and have a conversation, you know. And so when you are fortunate to work with somebody who is really, you know, into the same things and the same ideas as you, it's wonderful. And he was somebody that, obviously, judging by his films, they're very music-driven films. And you know, it was an incredible experience to be able to sort of constantly talk about, you know, I'd go in and I just want to talk about movies, and he just want to talk about records, and you know, and how we sort of worked in the middle. And it was an incredibly wonderful collaboration, and hopefully, you know, hopefully we'll do something again. You know, unfortunately we're meant to do Bond, but that didn't happen. So we'll see what happens.
Oh, we'll hear it. We'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. So let's listen to this. And I think I have it queued up properly this time. It's absolutely stunning. And it's really refined. I can even hear it in the drums and the rhythm and the sound, actually, of the rhythm section and the drums. I can really hear it's so much more refined than your earlier work. Do you feel the same way?
I hope
just
so.
Sonically, I mean.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. I mean, I hope so, because, you know, you hope to get better at something.
Well, I'm going to skip over now to the Trust soundtrack that you did for Danny Boyle, because we were talking about it earlier. It was a 10-part series about the kidnapping of John Paul Getty III.
Yes, right. Yeah.
Do you want to tell us how that all came about?
A lot of music, UNKLE records have been in Danny Boyle films. So Lonely Soul was actually the closing sequence of The Beach. And when I curated Meltdown, you know, what happens when you do Meltdown is you do this massive wish list. And they always say that they sort of laugh and they go, you do your wish list, but just don't be upset because about most of it won't happen. You know, so, you know, I'm sure everybody's gone in and gone, oh, we'll get, you know, get Led Zeppelin to reform or whatever, you know, for sake of argument. And, you know, but one act that I really wanted to have, but they weren't available at the time, was Underworld. And they then had a show a few months later after Meltdown at Royal Festival Hall. So I went to see the show. And at the after show, I was there and Danny Boyle was there. So I thought, you know, you've been using all these records over the years, I'll go and say hello. So I said hello and it was like, great. And, you know, exchange numbers and let's get together and have a chat and da, da, da. And so I texted him and I didn't hear anything back from him. And, you know, whatever. And then 4 years later, I get a text saying, hey, man, it's Danny here. I know it's been a bit long. I hope you're sorry that I get back to you on your last text. Do you fancy having a meeting and meeting up about doing a new project I'm working on? So I went to meet him and he told me that he was doing this television show, and it was, you know, the premise of the television show, which I really liked, and would I score the show? So that's how it started. Yeah.
So did you do this like scene by scene? How did it work putting all the music together for this?
Well, when you do, you know, I think when you do film and television, one of the most important things is sort of character, identifying characters. So what you start trying to do is work in music to identify a character, thematic things that run throughout a show or a film where you're, you know, when that person walks in, you know it's that person because sonically, you know, it kind of alludes to, you know, it gives you a sort of character piece. So I started by, you know, identifying the main characters and talking to him about, you know, ideas of what the pieces of music should be. And I also, the way we first started is he asked for every single piece of music that I'd worked on lately. And the Road Pot 1 hadn't come out. Yeah. So, you know, I gave him that and a lot of other tracks that hadn't made the Road Pot 1 demos, instrumentals. And so something, for instance, like the track we just listened to, that existed as a sort of instrumental piece that I had been working on but hadn't made the first record. And so I'd given him all this stuff, and then he started placing stuff. You know, you place stuff in, as placeholders within the edits, and then you start replacing that and recording new things. And so it's quite a sort of a process of sort of build and destroy, and trying to and sort of weaving through it. And what then happens with something like that, where it's 10 parts, so it's 10 hours. You know, Danny did the first three, is then you end up sort of going and working with other people, and how that develops, and you're taking these ideas on. I mean, Danny did laugh. He said the reason most musicians and great, you know, very successful arrangers and soundtrack people don't do television because it's exhausting. You know?
It must be, because you have, you know, to really edit everything so it fits the piece.
Well, it's just that you've got 10
narrative.
Hours. Most movies are a couple of hours.
True.
So you're, you know, at minimum, generally, most series is around 10 parts, if not longer. So it's quite a lot of work. But it was an incredible experience to do, and it was brilliant working with him. It was really great, and you know.
Would you do it again?
With him, yes.
Right.
And would I do another TV show? Yes, I of course, but depending on what it is. But I had the flip side of that recently. I worked on something like, you know, the problem with a lot of when you're working for other people and other people's visions is that what can be on paper doesn't necessarily always translate. Working with somebody like Danny, and I worked with Alfonso Cuarón recently, yes. Was something else that I didn't, and that can be quite difficult and disappointing.
Now, on this, you worked with a different string arranger, Philip Shepherd.
Yeah, so I worked with Will on a few things, but I also worked throughout my, you know, with UNKLE and a lot of the things I've done, I've also worked with this amazing cellist called Philip Shepherd. He's a composer, he's in his own right. He was also, for a long time, the head teacher at cello at the Royal Academy, and I started working with him on Never Neverland. The first song I ever did with him was a song called Eye for an Eye. And so when I work, for instance, with somebody like Will doesn't play, so you know you're coming up with ideas. He will take that arrangement, he will write the arrangement into a score, and you'll have an orchestra play it. And that tends to be usually a minimum of 12 and going plus. So most of the records like Lonely Soul that, you know, or Looking for the Rain that you just heard, those are usually around 30 people on a playing together. Whereas, which is amazing, but you can imagine it's not cheap.
Exactly.
To do. So when, you know, with a lot of, you know, I fortunately met this amazingly talented composer and player, Philip Shepherd, who is a one-man orchestra. And so Philip can play incredibly intimately and, you know, as a singular cellist, or he will layer and layer and layer and layer and create with him just playing the feeling of an orchestra. So I between, you know, I've worked basically pretty much, I've worked with a few other arrangers and people, but pretty consistently throughout my career, I've worked with both of them. And so, but a lot of the time when, you know, the sound is different because, you know, when you're in a certain room and you have a big orchestra, there's a different sort of power within the sound that you get. In Philip, Philip is very powerful a lot of the time with intimacy, because again, if you, you know, a big orchestra doesn't always create intimacy. And so depending on the type of song, the type of mood that you're trying to create, I work with different people depending on what I'm trying to get across sonically. So, for instance, the song that I want to play now is probably the longest piece of music in Trust, the TV show. And it's an opening sequence to an episode where the mother of this kidnapped, of John Paul Getty III, Jr., whatever, is really going through the emotional pain of knowing her son is lost and being told that her son has basically been burnt alive. Because what happened in that story is there was a kid that he became friend with the mafia who kidnapped him. They tried to escape, and one kid was killed and burnt alive. And they didn't, because he was thrown naked into a garbage dump or whatever, nobody knew whether it was who it was, because we don't have the same, you know, this is set in the 70s, so, you know, DNA, etc., forensics. So this opening sequence, which runs for about 4 or 5 minutes, is very emotional, and this is this moment of her thinking that she's lost her son, and also the fragility of her, which she was played by Hilary Swank, and very, very well. And you know, it's sort of going back to the idea of themes, a sort of fragile, this powerful woman, but somebody that's had the life beaten out of them by greedy men, and the son, you know, and the power of money, and the potential loss of her son. So it needed to be very intimate, you know.
And it's called Gail's Theme.
Yeah.
Wow. That's so haunting. And it reminds me more of what was at one point called new music, but what we call it contemporary classical, the Philip Glass, Steve Reich, yeah, Terry Riley. Yeah. Is that another inspiration to you, that
form
of music?
Yeah, absolutely. And Philip, you know, what's interesting with something like him is he's brilliant at manipulating sound within his performance. So you get, you know, this sort of mix of technology within classical performance, which is brilliant. He'll play with both an electric and, I mean, the first day he ever turned up to the studio, it's so funny. He's like, oh yeah, just got to be careful with this cello. I've just been given this cello at the moment. He walked into the studio with a Stratovarius that the Royal Academy had just lent him. Wow. And so, you know, he had a Stratovarius, which I think was valued at about £2.5 million, and then an electric cello. Even though the next session after that, I said, oh, where's the Stratovarius? He said, you know what, man? Just got this amazing Chinese cello. Don't tell the Royal Academy, but it sounds amazing. I'd just rather not use the other one.
Oh yeah,
it's too expensive to be. The insurance is freaking me out.
It's like in Spinal Tap. Don't even look at it.
Yeah, don't look at it. Don't touch it. Yeah. But he can, you know, his the sort of mix of how you can work with, you know, with interesting, you know, he uses a lot of pedals. And sort of, and putting it through interesting effects units and stuff like that, as well as, you know, in a sort of contemporary way. So a lot of the stuff I've done with him can get quite abstract and a bit weirder than more traditional string arrangements that I've done with people like Will.
Well, for our last piece, this is kind of a soundtrack in reverse, I think is the best way to talk about it. You were talking before how you work with Alfonso Cuarón. Do you want to speak about, he did a film called Roma, but the music that he used in the film, it wasn't like he had songs just playing on their own. It wasn't like a proper soundtrack.
There isn't really music. Really. It's radio, it's
exactly.
Sound,
incidental,
it's environment.
I don't know
incidental.
How you would call
there is,
it.
There is a tiny bit of score, but again, it doesn't feel like score.
Right.
You know, it's very much as anybody's seen the film, but it's very much a sort of, you're just watching life unfold and, you know, a relationship of life unfolded in front of you in the most amazing backdrop of 1970s Mexico city. But it's really the sounds of the city that you're engaged with rather than, you know, a score. I was asked by a mutual friend of mine that was the music supervisor for Roma. I didn't know about Roma. My friend called me from New York and said, look, do you like Alfonso's work? I was like, yep. I loved, you know, Gravity. It was fantastic that he'd done not too long ago. And then, you know, I liked, you know, I have a 21-year-old daughter. So I didn't do Star Wars. I did Harry Potter.
Me too.
You know, and so I really liked his work, and I liked his vibe as somebody that, you know, just seeing interviews and things. And so my friend said, do you want to go and see his new film? Because we wanted to talk to you about it. So I went to see a screening of Roma, which blew my mind, which I think if any of you haven't seen it, you need to see it because it's one of the great pieces of art that has come out in cinema in a long time. I think that and Cold War last year, but anyway. I saw the film, it blew me away, and I was asked if I wanted to react to the film and create a piece of music reacting to the movie, because he wanted to do a sort of inspired by soundtrack which he was curating of some of his favorite artists.
A great lineup, like Beck, yeah. Patti Smith, and yeah. even young artists like Billie Eilish.
Yeah, brilliant, yeah, really good. And so I, of course, was, you know, I said yes, and I sort of wanted to make... The idea was I wanted, you know, it's set in 73, so it's kind of... I'd just done Trust, which is set in... So it's same period, so I was kind of in that headspace a little bit, but I wanted, you know, hopefully something which was a little bit more contemporary. And I thought what a great opportunity it would be to work with somebody that I hadn't necessarily been able to work with before. So I'm a huge, huge fan of Michael Kiwanuka's work.
He's fantastic. Yeah. I saw him perform here at the Royal Albert Hall and just absolutely stunning.
I think he's one of the great singer-songwriters of contemporary singer-songwriters that come out of the UK in a long, long time for me. I think he just has... You know, the records he makes are the kind of records that I love, and the references, you know.
And all he's different a great kinds musicologist. Of references too, very versatile.
Very versatile, but you know, but that he's just got that, you know, that soul in his music that, and I'd really wanted to make something which was more coming from that world, something which was, you know, was more of a had a more of a soul type of vocal on the track, and I had this arrangement and this track that I'd worked on with Will, and I was keeping it for, you know, I sort of hadn't quite finished it, and when I saw the film and I was asked if I had something that I felt I could make or would be appropriate, I felt that I wanted the song to be like the end, you know, I wanted to imagine it as the end titles of the film, and I asked Michael if he'd be up for it, and he was, and we went in the studio and I explained to him that, you know, to me, what I got from this film was this sort of feeling of, it's like a prayer, you know, it brings you to your knees, you know, as a this sort of relationship with family and love and loss and all of these things. And that was where this song kind of came out of. So
let's have a listen.
And it's the last thing I've made. So.
That is so gorgeous. And I can hear how we started our conversation about things like Adagio for strings and Unfinished Sympathy. I can hear that inspiration just poking through right there. Absolutely beautiful.
Thank you.
I love that. Well, now is the time for us to hand the microphone over to all of you if you have any questions that you would like to ask Mr. Lavelle yourself. Is there a roving microphone somewhere? Yes, there is. Just raise your hand if you'd like to ask a question. Oh, we have a shy audience tonight. Oh, here we go. Here, lady right here in the front.
Hi, thank you very much for everything that you've shared with us this evening. So I'm just interested in actually these string arrangements, because obviously that's such an important part of your work, and the fact that you are a cellist yourself. So how does that creative process work when you're working with someone else? How do you communicate your ideas? Do you give them a score? Do you give them a template of a song? Do you get your cello out? I don't know.
Interesting. It really depends on the situation. I mean, a lot of the time, myself and whoever I'm working with on a production level will have done a track with a guide vocal, and we will have done a string arrangement on a synthesizer or whatever, or you know, synthesized strings, and then I will then play that to whoever I'm working with, and that will be the basis, and it's then how that alludes. And it's funny that one of the biggest things in my world and making records, because actually I don't get the cello out because I can't play anymore and I'm not very technical, is that articulating things and being with people that understand what you're referencing is so important. So, you know, most of the relationships with people like Philip or Will and people like that, that, you know, it's because we have a really great way of understanding sonically when we describe something or we reference something. There's a kind of understanding, and that can be from referencing something from a film to a mood to a track that, you know, to a song or whatever. So, for instance, we're looking for the rain. You know, when I was with Will, we had, you know, you have the main line, but when it goes off, and the twist is that, you know, I was like sort of trying to get him to reference Lawrence of Arabia, and trying to get something more in that world or more of an Eastern sound to what was doing, or but then other times you're referencing really sort of train spotty records. So sometimes I found in my creative process that I can be in the studio with somebody and trying to articulate what it is that I want to achieve, and I'll be like, well, you know, it's that record that was, you know, I don't know, for sake of argument, you're referencing a kind of underground techno record or something. If that person doesn't understand, it's very difficult to make a record, you know, to move forward. So yeah, most of the people I work with, there's this kind of weird language that we all speak where we kind of understand references and stuff, you know.
Anyone else? Well, then I'll ask the last question. Okay. So when are you going to start work on part three?
I've already started working on part three. But sorry, my phone's ringing really annoyingly. It's the only time it has on silent. The record's just come out, so I'm obviously sort of living with that, and there's still stuff that I'm doing with the part two. But, and I have a lot of tracks that I've worked on for part three, but I'm also, I think I might take a minute and take a breath and sort of see, you know, there's sort of take some time to sort of, yeah, I don't know. I sort of feel right now, I was in a very big mood to rush and keep going, and now I sort of feel like I want to sit back a bit. And there's other things that, you know, I'm sort of working on a big show at Saatchi Gallery this summer, which is a big sound installation based on the two records so far, with all of the visual artists involved. So I'm sort of going to do that and just sort of see how things go this record. I don't know, just take things in and see where I go. I don't know, I'm sort of... And I might do things in a slightly different way. I don't know, you know, the album thing is an interesting cycle at the moment, and just how you get to that point and how you present things. And I think with part three, I want to try some things out.
I really look forward to it. And any plans on performing any of this live with the full orchestra?
Well, I did a show recently at the Royal Festival Hall with Philip Shepherd, which was brilliant. I'm doing summer stuff, and then I'm looking at a big show in the beginning and towards the end of this year, I think, which will be orchestra led. Yeah.
Well, we'll look out for that. Thank you so much for joining us. Please give a hand to James Lavelle.
Thank Thanks very much.
And I also want to thank Infidelity and Bowers & Wilkins for this lovely sound system, to the Royal Albert Hall for having us back. We love Classic Album Sundays. We love collaborating with the Royal Albert Hall. It's a beautiful place to hold music events. But most of all, I want to thank all of you for listening. Thank you very much.